So we had so far two results from chapter one and two results from chapter two. The first were from chapter one, where we cleaned up a couple of results related to, really related to kind of perpendicular bisectors and right triangles. The first was 1.5.2, which showed that if I place a point on one side of a perpendicular bisector of a segment, then that point will be closer to the vertex on its same side than it is to the vertex on the opposite side of the perpendicular bisector. So in this figure, P is on the same side of the bisector from A to B as A was. So P is sort of located to the right, if you like. And we then showed that PB was less than PA. P is closer to B than it is to A. And the key to that proof, and it took us a little bit of sort of wandering around before we figured out what the key to this proof is, was to discover and use an isosceles triangle, which we did by making the triangle ABQ, or as I like to say, Albuquerque. And that's actually a point that I want to pause and call this feature out, because we also use this very same feature in the concurrency proof for the perpendicular bisectors that we just saw. So we knew that by definition, this perpendicular bisector cuts the segment AB in half. So we knew that AM and BM were congruent segments. That's by definition of perpendicular bisector. But then also here, we used the fact that AQ is congruent to BQ, but how did we know that at this stage? How do we know this was an isosceles triangle? I think we made a quick argument about it when we did this part of the proof, but what was the argument?
Side angle side.
So which proved the congruency of which triangles?
AQM
and BQM were congruent. Right, so that was an important fact for this proof. And the reason that they're congruent is because of side angle side. The first of those sides being QM, which is a common side for both of our two triangles. Then there was the angle, which because it was a perpendicular bisector, that's a right angle that it makes with the segment AB, and therefore it's also a right angle on the other side, right? Its supplementary angle will be 90 degrees. And then the third side, we get congruency of, again, by definition, a perpendicular bisector because AM was equal to BM. And so we had these two triangles, AQM and BQM, that are congruent. And as a result, AQ is equal to BQ. So that's the equidistance result that we also used in the concurrency proof. Therefore, AQ is equal to BQ. So that's a result that seems pretty important because it comes back to help us again later on too. But then because that was an isosceles triangle, we then applied the triangle inequality to the triangle QPB. And that's where this statement here came from. It showed us that PB had to be shorter than the sum of PQ and QB. But because QB and QA were the same by our isosceles result, that means PB is less than the sum of PQ and QA, but the sum of PQ and QA is the same as PA because Q lies on the segment between P and A. And so in the end, we were able to prove that PA was greater than PB. So P is closer to B than it is to A. It's one of those statements that's easy to see in a picture, but then to kind of discover what its foundational roots are, it definitely took some work. It took the triangle inequality, it took an SAS congruency argument to argue why those triangles are isosceles, and then we also used the form of the triangle inequality that relates to collinear points to justify why that last statement there holds. And we used a similar argument, just charged up with the angle side inequality, to justify 1.5.3, which was the statement that in a right triangle, the hypotenuse is always the longest side. We could prove this with the Pythagorean theorem if we had the Pythagorean theorem at our disposal, because the Pythagorean theorem would tell us that C squared
is equal to a squared plus b squared. And because a, b, and c are all greater than 0, so a is greater than 0 and b is greater than 0, that those two things taken together would imply that c squared is bigger, strictly bigger, than a squared, and c squared is strictly bigger than b squared. Right? And then taking the square root, which is a monotone function, we would conclude that c is greater than a and c is greater than b. So this would be the Pythagorean theorem proof of this. But we're not allowed to use that because we don't have the Pythagorean theorem in evidence yet. The Pythagorean theorem has not, we've not been able to deduce the Pythagorean theorem from the foundational information in our course so far. We'll do it in the next chapter, chapter 3. So without it, we were able to use two facts. First of all, that the sum of the interior angles of a triangle add up to 180. And so that puts a cap on how many total degrees I can have in all three of my angles. And then when one of those angles is a right angle, that means that the other two by themselves have to add up to the remaining 90 degrees that the angle P didn't take up. So that was the first fact. And then the second fact was this all-important angle-side inequality, which we've seen now come up in a few different places, that says that bigger sides are opposite bigger angles. In a triangle. And so that implies that it suffices to show, if we want to argue that the hypotenuse is the longest side, it suffices to show that the angle which it's opposite to is the biggest angle, has the largest measure. That's what 1.2.9 would do for us. And so from there, it's just a matter of arguing that because Q and R together have to add up to 90, and because each one of them is positive, so Q is greater than 0, and angle R in measure is greater than 0, that implies, since they add up to 90 degrees, that Q has to be less than 90. But since 90 is the measure of P, that means that Q is less than P. And therefore, the side opposite Q is less than the side opposite P, which is C. And so we know the hypotenuse is longer than the side A, and analogously for the other side as well. So the Pythagorean theorem is not all that it's cracked up to be. I mean, it certainly is a really important result, but we didn't need it to prove that the hypotenuse of a triangle is its longest side.